On behalf of the Humanities Institute, I'd like to welcome you to the New York Botanical Garden, located on the ancestral homeland of the Lenape Delaware people. We honor them and acknowledge their displacement, dispossession, and continued presence. Today, it is my great pleasure to introduce the first food dialogue of 2023, The Food of Poetry, featuring award-winning poet Dante Micheaux from the Cave Canem Foundation. This event is actually doing double duty today, as it is the first day of National Poetry Month, and we are honored to have Dante here with us today to celebrate. The food dialogue started in spring 2021 as a partnership between the Humanities Institute and Dr. Jessica B. Harris, with generous support from the Mellon Foundation, as a series of rich conversations with prominent chefs, authors, and food historians, examining how notions of heritage and identity are shaped through food. In 2021, we explored the theme Reclaiming Cultural Heritage. In 2022, we celebrated contributions of African-American farmers to the food, history, and culture of the United States. And in 2023, we will be exploring the theme Preserving Histories, how authors use plants and plant-based narratives to tell stories about history, identity, and lived experience, and as a vehicle to express cultural relationships. Throughout the year, we'll be featuring prominent literary figures, including Dante Micheaux today and Jamaica Kincaid on June 17th as part of the Garden's Juneteenth celebrations. Dr. Harris has guided and shaped the series since its inception, as well as curated NYBG's African American Garden, which will return this June with a Caribbean flavor and is an absolute must-see. Dr. Harris is America's leading scholar on the food and foodways of the African diaspora. In 2020, she received the James Beard Lifetime Achievement Award. In 2021, she was listed as one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people in the world. In 2022, the Netflix series High on the Hog, inspired by her 12th book, won both a Peabody and an NAACP Image Award, and was nominated by the James Beard Foundation for Best Documentary. High on the Hog was renewed by Netflix for a second season and should be available for viewing later this year. Dr. Harris also serves on NYBG's Board of Trustees. So without further ado, I'm honored to turn the podium over to Dr. Harris to introduce our fantastic guest, Dante Micheaux, today for this important and transformative series. Thank you so much.
Good morning. How are you all? I have what I call Harris's rules for the classroom, and Harris's rules for the classroom state: if there are two people in a classroom, one will sit there and one will sit there. Please come down front if you can. If you can't, I understand, but let's bunch up. There are a few of us, and if we can bunch up to the degree that you are comfortable, I know COVID isn't over, that will make us all have another kind of experience. Hi, how are you? Welcome all. We are just so honored today to have Dante Micheaux with us. He is a friend of the garden, a friend of the African American garden particularly. Dante is the author of Circus, which won the Four Quartets Prize from the Poetry Society of America and the T.S. Eliot Foundation, and my favorite title of all, Amorous Shepherd. His poems and translations have appeared in African American Review, the American Poetry Review, Kalalu, Literary Imagination, Poem a Day, Poetry, and Tongue, among others, because he's prolific and widely published. Micheaux's honors include the Oscar Wilde Award and the Ambit Poetry Prize, and fellowships from the New York Times Foundation and the Cave Canem Foundation, where he currently serves as director of programs. Dante, as you will find out very shortly, is a marvelous reader of poems, not only his, but those of others, and an incredible steward of poetry. So please welcome to the podium, Dante Micheaux.
Then, far down at the corner, I saw an old man warming his hands against the sides of an odd-looking wagon from which a stovepipe reeled off a thin spiral of smoke that drifted to the odor of baking yams slowly to me, bringing a stab of swift nostalgia. I stopped as though struck by a shot, deeply inhaling, remembering, my mind surging back, back. At home, we'd baked them in hot coals of the fireplace, had carried them cold to school for lunch, munched them secretly, squeezing the sweet pulp from the soft peel as we hid from the teacher behind the largest book, the world's geography. Yes, and we'd loved them candied or baked in cobbler, deep fat fried in a pocket of dough, or roasted with pork and glazed with the well-brown fat. Had chewed them raw, yams and years ago. More yams than years ago, though the time seemed endlessly expanded, stretched thin as the spiraling smoke beyond all recall. I moved again. "Get your hot baked carline of yams," he called. At the corner, the old man, wrapped in an army overcoat, his feet covered with gunny sacks, his head in a knitted cap, was puttering with a stack of paper bags. I saw a crude sign on the side of the wagon proclaiming yams as I walked flush into the warmth thrown by the coals that glowed in a grate underneath. "How much are your yams?" I said, suddenly hungry. "They 10 cents and they sweet," he said, his voice quavering with age. "These ain't none of them binding ones neither. These here is real sweet, yaller lambs." "How many?" "One," I said. "If they're that good, one should be enough." He gave me a searching glance. There was a tear in the corner of his eye. He chuckled and opened the door of the improvised oven, reaching gingerly with his gloved hand. The yams, some bubbling with syrup, lay on a wire rack above glowing coals that leaped to low blue flame when struck by the draft of air. The flash of warmth set my face aglow as he removed one of the yams and shut the door. "Here you are, sir," he said, starting to put the yam into the bag. "Never mind the bag, I'm going to eat it, here." "Thanks," he took the dime. "If that ain't a sweet one, I'll give you another one free of charge." I knew that it was sweet before I broke it. Bubbles of brown syrup had burst the skin. "Go ahead and break it," the old man said. "Break it and I'll give you some butter since you're gonna eat it right here. Lots of folks take some home where they have their own butter." I broke it, seeing the sugary pulp steaming in the cold. "Hold it over here," he said. He took a crock from a rack on the side of the wagon, right here. I held it, watching him pour a spoonful of melted butter over the yam and the butter seeping in. "Thanks." "You welcome, and I'll tell you something." "What's that?" I said. "If that ain't the best eating you had in a long time, I'll give you your money back." "You don't have to convince me," I said. "I can look and see it's good." "You right, but everything what looks good ain't necessarily good," he said, "but these is." I took a bite, finding it as sweet and hot as any I'd ever had, and was overcome with such a surge of homesickness that I turned away to keep my control. I walked along munching the yam, just as suddenly overcome by an intense feeling of freedom, simply because I was eating while walking along the street. It was exhilarating. I no longer had to worry about who saw me or about what was proper. To hell with all that. And as sweet as the yam actually was, it became like nectar with the thought. That's Ralph Ellison from The Invisible Man. So I know this talk is supposed to be about food and poetry, but I wanted to open with that scene from Invisible Man because the great poem about sweet potatoes has not been written yet. And I think that is as close to the feeling of eating a sweet potato as I've been able to find in all of Black literature. And it's appropriate because there's something about the opening paragraph and the last paragraph of that section that is highly lyrical. In fact, I would argue that those paragraphs are actually prose poems flanking this dialogue between the protagonist of Ellison's novel and the yam seller. Food takes a central role in lots of African American literature, poetry in particular, but it's not just food, it's about the raising of food, the nurturing, the distraction that it has brought from many, many trying times for African-American people in this country in particular. And it has also been a source of refuge. The next poem I'm going to read is called For a Farmer. It was written by the African-American poet James Emmanuel, who many people don't know. Emmanuel left the United States mid last century and vowed that he would never come back to the States until the black man had equal rights. And sorry to say, he died in France because he never came back. This is a poem he wrote in about the 1950s called For a Farmer. Something slow moves through him, watched by hills. Something low within reach, rock receives his noonday wish. Then crumbles rich, so fills each furrow that the prairie year upheaves. His arms has lain with boulders. His copper hand has mused on roots, uncaring of barbed wire. His fist has closed on thistle and dug the land for corn October snows have whelmed entire. Something flows with him in stubborn streams, and in the parted foliage, something lives in upright green, stirred by the rhythmic gleams of his hoe and spade. From worn out arms he gives, the earth receives, turns all his pain to soil, where he believes and testifies through toil. It's a very moving poem about a man who likely in this context was a sharecropper, and he finds such solace in the work that he's really forced to do in order to provide for his family and quite possibly the community. It strikes me as being particularly close to my own family story. My maternal great-grandfather was a sharecropper in the southern part of Georgia, right along the Florida border. And he was a little more industrious than the farmer of James Emmanuel's poem because he also made moonshine, which brought in a considerable amount of income during the Prohibition era. And so he was able to use that income not only to provide for his family, but also for some of the working class white people who lived in the nearby county. But black culture and the remnants of enslavement aren't always the focal point of how food plays a part in the literature. Food also can be quite emblematic of other things, and there's a poem I'd like to read to you by the great poet Essex Hemphill, and it's entitled Black Beans, and there are no children in the audience, so it was good. Black beans. Times are lean, pretty baby. The beans are burnt to the bottom of the battered pot. Let's make fierce love on the overstuffed hand-me-down sofa. We can burn it up too. Our hungers will evaporate like money. I smell your lust, not the pot burnt black with tonight's meager meal. So we can't buy flowers for our table. Our kisses are petals. Our tongues caress the bloom. Who dares to tell us we are poor and powerless? We keep treasure any king would count as dear. Come on, pretty baby. Our souls can't be crushed like cats crossing streets too soon. Let the beans burn all night long. Our chipped water glasses are filled with wine from our loving. And the burnt black beans, caviar. I think it's a wonderful love poem. Essex Hemphill was a brilliant activist and not only a poet, but a writer of short stories, memoir, who unfortunately succumbed to AIDS in the 1990s. And I think that is an example of his poetry at its most powerful, subtle, interested in the erotic, using food as it is often found in poetry, both African-American poetry and in other traditions, as a source to focus someone's desires or lust. Another poem by the living Elizabeth Alexander really speaks to the way poetry or the way food functions as a portal to familial memory. And this poem harkens back to a single ingredient that is important in the culture of this particular family. The title of the poem is called Butter. My mother loves butter more than I do, more than anyone. She pulls chunks off the stick and eats it plain, explaining cream spun around into butter. Growing up, we ate turkey cutlets sauteed in lemon and butter, butter and cheese on green noodles, butter melting in small pools in the hearts of Yorkshire puddings, butter better than gravy staining white rice yellow, butter glazing corn in slipping squares, butter the lava in white volcanoes of hominy grits, butter softening in a white bowl to be creamed with white sugar, butter disappearing into whipped sweet potatoes with pineapple, butter melted and curdy to pour over pancakes, butter licked off the plate with warm alaga syrup. When I picture the good old days, I am grinning greasy with my brother, having watched the tiger chase his tail and turn to butter. We are Mumbo and Jumbo's children despite historical revision, despite our parents' efforts, glowing from the inside out, 100 megawatts of butter. And before I read from my own work, there's a poem that has stuck with me for a long time by one of my favorite poets, whose name is Carl Phillips. And this poem is a great example of the way desire works. And there is an element of food here, though. It's not the humans that are eating it. It's called Parable. There was a saint once. He had but to ring across water a small bell. All manner of fish rose as answer. He was that holy, persuasive, both. Or the fish perhaps merely hungry, their bodies a shimmer with that hope especially that hunger brings. Whatever the reason, the fish coming unassigned in schools coming into the saint's hand and instead of getting, becoming food. I have thought since of your body as I first came to know it, how still it can be with mine sometimes. I think on that immediate and last gesture of the fish leaving water for flesh. For guarantee, they will die. And I cannot rest on what to call it. So, the last poem I'll read before Jessica and I have a bit of a conversation is a little bit of a sentimental poem about my grandmother with whom I was very close. And it's titled Dream of My Grandmother. She was in her fineries, a dark brown suit, hemline just above the knee and kick pleat, a complimentary blouse, off-white, no, kind of like an eggshell color. The hose were coffee, medium-sized, from the corner store, because it don't make no sense to spend that much money for some pantyhose. The shoes of the 98 pairs cleared from her closet were black D'Orsays, always a low heel, the uppers cut on the inside of the foot, embellished with eyelets, a gold pendant engraved with the faces of her parents, clip-on earrings, the hat, her most important accessory, chocolate felt, pillbox cap, and a large brim, both trimmed in black, with a chocolate and black cockade in the back. And, draped over the shoulders, a pewter mink coat, which she never wore because the damn thing was too heavy, but I admired. She was flanked by two brothers, the youngest two, both of whom preceded her in death. One she loved, and the other she couldn't stand. She brought sweet potato pie and macaroni salad and asked me to choose. The choosing kept me asleep when sleep was what I needed most. Thanks. Ah, sorry, a request has come in. So, I'm just going to read the first section, well, the third section, actually, of a book-length poem, which was featured in last year's African-American Garden in the Poetry Walk. And I think this is how the relationship between me and the garden began. I don't know, someone, maybe Barbara, in the audience, yes, found this poem and showed it to Jessica, so. I'll just give you some context for the poem. It will eventually be book length. It's got many, many sections made up of 20-line stanzas that are quite dense. They're in concert with one another on the page, so that on the one page you have memories and biographical material from the life of my maternal great-grandmother. And on the other side, you have this fictional, speculative poem where I am speaking to her from my present time, and she's in about 1940s Georgia. She can hear me, no one else can hear me, and we have a conversation with one another across time. From Pelham. Weeds, but welcomed flora, never a remedy waste. Outside the house, a yard. Outside the yard, pens. Outside the pens, a road. Beyond the road, the field and more field. But the last field gives way to wood. Such would it be a wonder. Kudzu, cloaking the squat trees gathered like a congregation hiding its worship. Its opening, invisible to the strange eye, reveals a pond's bank rich with red berry root and sassafras, enough wealth to ward off ailment, collected with care in the fold of an apron and the little girl's skirt, so pleased with helping her mother carry back the bounty that would be medicine, to wash gently and bind, to hang from a string hung taut against the back wall of the kitchen, to dry, to separate leaf from stem, to crush leaf in hand and sprinkle into the water boiling for tea, or mix into a rendered fat for salve. Though there were other cures that had been shared and miscegenated, committed, brought down, and burnished through generations, oil and turpentine, sweet gum or stinking gum, camphor, cherry bark, or red oak bark for the gut misery. Thanks.
First of all, thank you for those lovely readings. The gentleness is the word that comes immediately to mind. with which you read is just so evocative. First question. In the very first piece that you read, Ellison, okay, are we back to, can you hear me? Can we try it again? In the first piece that you read, Ellison speaks of the evocative power of the scent of roasting yams. And here I open a professorial parenthesis. I wouldn't be myself if I didn't say those are, in fact, not yams. Those are sweet potatoes. Yams is a different thing botanically. But he talks about them as yams. What food would take you back in that manner?
I think it would be sweet potatoes, in fact. That's why I chose the excerpt. Thinking about my grandmother, who I spent most of my childhood at her knee, making sweet potato pie, and when she got to be a certain age, and actually when I got to be a certain age, she realized that I could do the mashing and she wouldn't have to. So I was probably around 10 or 11 when I made my first sweet potato pie, but the smell of them cooking in her house does that for me. I feel when I make the pies now and I smell them cooking, I feel like my grandmother is with me. And there was, you know, everybody has their own technique, and the recipe is the same over the years from her mother, but everyone does something a little different. My grandmother used to boil her potatoes first, and so you would just smell the whole house with like a sweet potato steam. It just got everywhere. And I knew the good that was coming. When we were all together, we were probably about, 14. And so, you know how Black people are, everybody wants to take home a plate. And we knew sweet potato pie would go quickest. And so my grandmother and I would bake probably 6 to 8 pies, and we always hid 2 underneath the vegetable drawer in the refrigerator, because then people would say, oh, we've got to get our pie, there's none left. They would leave and I would stay, and my grandmother and I would have these 2 sweet potato pies. Yeah. I mean, it was more like 1.5 went to me and 1/2 went to her.
Oh, that's a wonderful story. Now, Dante and I actually have a sweet potato pie story, because I was in London. You forgot.
No, I didn't forget.
Okay,
didn't forget.
All right. I was in London last April, and I arrived in my hotel room, and there was this beautifully wrapped in cellophane sweet potato pie, but there was no note. And so it's like, is it from the hotel? Well, this is London. They wouldn't do sweet. I didn't know who the pie came from. Now, being a lovely paranoid American, it's like, well, I'm not going to eat that till I know where it's from. So eventually, we found out where it was from, and I took it to a friend's house, and Dante can make a mean sweet potato pie. So don't let him hide them under the vegetable drawer. You know where those are now. Look there, too.
I think this is a picture of my Thanksgiving table from last year, and there's a little bit of the sweet potato pie that you can see on the left side.
I'm coming to London.
this was in the Berkshires in Massachusetts. Yeah.
London's worth the trip though.
Yeah.
For the pie. Okay, but in talking about one more on the pies. In talking about that whole idea of the sweet potato, and obviously it's sort of totemic for you, why haven't you written the great poem on sweet potatoes?
Because it's hard. I think it's much easier for me to write about things that are not so close to me. So for example, Pelham is written about my great-grandmother. I did not know her. She died in 1962. But the stories I know about her are all from my grandmother, so it's a way for me to write actually about my grandmother and her childhood, because she's so close to me. I think that's why I haven't been able to write. I have thought about it and I try to get the language for it, but I'm just too close to it. I need some distance. Maybe if I were living somewhere very, very foreign to my experience, like, I don't know, Borneo for a year, at the end of that time, I might be ready to write about it just because I would have had the distance from it.
Okay, well, that brings me to my next question, which is, what is your process? How do you start? What sparks a poem?
Language always sparks a poem for me. I'm a big eavesdropper, a really big eavesdropper. And people say the most fascinating poetic things. My mother's birthday was yesterday, and she's a holy roller, so I took her to one of those big Christian theater plays called Sight and Sound is the theater. She went to see a play called Moses. And the people sitting next to me were Muslim, and they were speaking Urdu. And I could recognize the language. And I thought it odd, it's Ramadan, here are these two Muslims at this Christian play. And they were talking about something and the woman said, mashallah. And maybe five words later, she said, responding to something in the play, hallelujah. Mashallah and hallelujah in the same breath, really, made me tingle, you know, made my cerebral thinking about poetry tingle. And so I will hold on to that phrase probably for years, and it will end up in a poem. It usually starts that way. And I build from there. I have, for now, and I hope it lasts into my dotage, but I have a very good memory. And when I talk to my poet friends, they're always surprised that generally I compose poems in my head. So by the time I sit down to write them onto a page, all of the work has already been done. I've been thinking about the rhythm, I've been thinking about the meter, and when I sit down to write, I am sitting down to just sort of make a deposit in the bank, as it were, because all of the work has been done in my head.
Okay, wow, that's fascinating. You talk about your poet friends. How did you select the poems that you read earlier? Are they from your poet friends, alive or dead, and how would you define them? And could you tell us a little bit about why you selected each poem?
Sure. Well, I'm really interested from an artistic point of view, an aesthetic point of view, but also from a cultural working point of view in literary history. And though Black poets are really having a heyday now, and we win all the awards, and we're always on television, and we've been poet laureates, and all of that wonderful stuff, there is a generation of Black poets who did not get that recognition, who were working and publishing and supporting one another, and it's very important to me that those stories are told. When I was younger and living in Paris, a poetry teacher of mine named Marilyn Hacker is a wonderful poet. She lives in Paris, and she said, you know, there's a poet here you should know named James Emmanuel. And I thought, never heard of him. And she said, yeah, he's American, Black American. He's been living here since whenever. And he lives in Montparnasse. You should go and visit him. I said, well, I'm just go to the man's house. And she said he would love it. So she gave me his address, and I knocked up in my 20s and said, hi, Mr. Emmanuel, you know, I'm a poet here and I'm living in Paris, and Marilyn Hacker said that I should come and visit you. And he was a lovely old man. I wouldn't say that he was a friend, but I got to know him while I was living there. And he had great stories because he was friends with everybody. He was friends with Baldwin. He was friends with Gordon Heath. And he would see lots of Black Americans coming to Paris. But he was there for decades working and writing, and I thought it's thinking about food and poetry. I wanted to start off at least the poetry portion. I'll go back to Ellison later. The poetry portion with that work in the field that was so essential to our culture. And the fact that this farmer, whom even his, the people who most closely surrounded him would have thought he was just out there working, but he was having this whole cerebral and spiritual experience, and I thought that was very evocative. So that's why I chose James Emmanuel. Elizabeth Alexander is a friend, and I just love that poem of hers. It's from her first book, you know, that, and her poems have moved in a different direction since that first book, but I just thought it was such a wonderful celebration of that. And Carl Phillips is my, you know, there's a difference between someone's favorite artist and an artist who you think is the best in your field. And I think Carl Phillips is certainly one of the best writers in our language, but he's my favorite poet. He's the poet that I think, you know, if I'm on my deathbed, that's who I want to be reading. And that poem is just gorgeous. It's in a book of his called Pastoral. If you want some great reading, get Pastoral by Carl Phillips. He is also a friend. And I did not know Essex Hemphill, but as a gay black man, he's sort of, I'll use your word, totemic for many of us. And he was the first, I guess he was the first openly gay poet that I'd ever come across in my reading. And when I was in my adolescence, a high school friend is sitting in the audience, and we went to high school in Princeton. And there was a little bookshop on the corner of Witherspoon Street called at the time Pyramid Books, and it was run by a gay man named Michael Walwork. And the gay and lesbian section at that time, first of all, there was a gay and lesbian section. And at that time, it was the bottom shelf in a corner of the bookstore. And I would sneak in on Wednesday afternoons and just read what was there. And that's how I discovered Essex Hemphill. So he's sort of a friend in the spirit realm. And then Ellison, which is not a poem, but I think is very poetic, I chose because it is the 70th anniversary of the publication of Invisible Man, and Ralph Ellison's birthday was a month ago today, and I just want people to be thinking about him and remembering this great artistic output that he left us with. So, yeah.
Okay, wow.
Food.
Uh-oh. No, not uh-oh.
Just curious, food, what sparks you? I mean, the eroticism of food is something that I was aware of listening to you read. Just the butter, you know, which really wasn't necessarily an erotic poem. Some of the others perhaps were a little bit more erotic in that sense. How do those connect, or do they connect for you?
Absolutely. I mean, I am maybe notorious, I was going to say famous for saying, but I might be notorious for saying that, you know, from my own individualist perspective, food and sex are pretty much the same thing. They are. They fire off. They fire off the same kinds of chemical reactions in the brain. People do crazy things for both of them. And I think that the idea of hunger as being a synonym for desire is not something that originated with me. So I do think there is something that keeps them correlated. But there is something very erotic about food in the way that it causes your senses to react. When your eyes are bigger than your stomach, or when you smell something and you begin salivating, those are chemical reactions that are happening in your body very much in the same way when you see someone you're attracted to.
Yeah.
Same chemical reactions. But also food is, I'm crazy about food.
Yes, I know.
A good friend of mine, Margot Bertaszewski, is another poet. She lives in Paris. And she also loves the sweet potato pie. So every time I go to Paris, I come on the Eurostar with a pie, freshly baked pie in hand. And she was at my house some years ago, just before COVID, and we were having a meal, and we were drinking. She's a great drinker. And I was waxing poetic about some cocktail or something. And she leaned in the table and she said, "Why don't you write about food? I think you're more passionate about food than you are about anything else." She said, "You should just write about food." And I thought, again, I'm too close to it. I don't know if the sound, if you can still hear, but I'm too close to the way it makes me feel to be able to write about it again. Maybe if I like went on one of these
We're sending you retreats. To Borneo.
Yeah, send me to Borneo where I'm like on a food cleanse, then I might be able to write about food in a better way.
I think the world is missing a great food poet.
Maybe.
Yeah. One last question, and then I'm going to ask you to read one last piece. We haven't talked about, well, we have a little bit with the James Emmanuel, but growing, the garden. What are your memories of the garden? How do they fit? Do they show up in your poetry?
Certainly. Well, again, being very close to my grandmothers, my maternal grandmother, about whom the poem Dream of My Grandmother is about, she did not have a garden. But she is the person who I watched cook the most and who I talked about the techniques that she had learned and developed over the years. And I learned a great deal about the farm on which she grew up, where some members of my family still live in this small town of Pelham, Georgia. And so in my young imagination, growing up in Trenton, New Jersey, where I'm from, hearing about this place that I certainly couldn't look out the window and see, I guess sparked something about my imagination. And the interesting thing was I learned so much about the innovation of what my own people were doing with elements from the natural world. You know, the things that they grew, that they cultivated, that they cared for, they did not just eat. You know, they ate and then they made things from them and they utilized the things that they made from them. Some of the things they made their lives easier. And so that was very important. My paternal grandmother, who is still alive and who came to visit the garden, thanks to Vanessa, earlier this year, was it? Yeah, it was earlier this year, September. Well, that was last year, goodness. She had a garden in her backyard, and when we were little, she has 30 grandchildren. I'm the third oldest. When we were little, or at least the older half of us, she grew corn in an urban city, like concrete sidewalks, row houses. In her backyard, she grew corn, tomatoes, and collard greens. And we would play in the backyard, and she would, in fact, it does show up in my poetry in a poem about her that was written for her 80th birthday. She's now 86. Her voice comes in the poem saying, you know, you can play out there all you want to, but don't go running in my, you know, don't go running in my corn. And she would always have a 4th of July family reunion, and all of the relatives from the South would come to Trenton. And she would harvest her, whatever she had grown at the time, and she would cook. And though they were both from the South, they had different methods of cooking. So my grandmother from Georgia was this is how I describe her, she was a shallow fryer. She fried her chicken shallow in a cast iron pan, slow and turned. My paternal grandmother is a deep fryer, so she fries her chicken in a big pot of oil. Yeah, cast iron still, but a lot more oil. And so they had lots of different techniques. My paternal grandmother never put sugar in her cornbread, but my maternal grandmother did. So there are all those different nuances that I have learned to weave and develop my own recipes.
Different sides of the vibe.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. Well, thank you so much. I haven't looked at my watch. I guess I should. We have about 5 minutes.
Yeah.
May I ask you for a memorable poem? I know you've got another little bit for us.
I'm going to read just another section of Pelham. And I'm going to read from here. I don't need to go to the podium, I don't think. And I think this stanza is also an answer to the question about how do these things turn up in the poetry. One small, sure handful at a time flies the coarser stuff. The little girl makes deft work of feeding chickens the rough sand of corn from a shallow bowl in the crook of her arm. Barefoot, while the ground is still cool, she makes no sound that startles the fowl. No here, chick, 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 chicken, to lure them closer. No running at all when fed well, she learned, to keep their meat from turning tough. The hens drift toward the safe food, no fear of competition, and the rooster waits up on the fence to eat right from her hand. Strut, strut, the honor of capon at Christmas. Occasionally she slopped the hogs. Boys' brawn was saved for field work. Potato peels, corn cobs, eggshells, carrot tops, onion skins, apple cores, the stems of collard greens. There was canning to do, seemed like all day preparing fruits and vegetables that could not be cut any which way, not only to fit in jars, but so the pantry would look pretty. Her favorite chore by far was making brooms, join her brothers in the field when the sun was hot, to cut corn straw and hunt for a stick thick as her wrist and as high as her plus half, sweep with the things she made.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
I, normally the point at which I would ask, are there any questions? But we don't have anyone to really kind of come and get your question. So if you have a question.
If you ask your question, I will repeat it just, so that the rest of the audience can hear.
You want me to get the microphone and run around?
Well, no, don't run around.
No, okay.
If you just say your question and I'll repeat it for
if you have any questions.
If you have any questions. Sure. Thank you. For those of you who couldn't hear, this wonderful person in the audience said that when I began reading, she recognized the text right away as something she'd read in high school 50 years ago. So I'm glad that you got to read it then. I hope people are still reading it in high school. It is a little dated, I have to say, reading it again.
Oh, absolutely.
But I think for contemporary audiences.
It's such a classic food passage. I actually included it in High on the Hog.
Yeah.
It's got, you know, it's just that thing that makes you know something about, first of all, about the Great Migration, mm-hmm. and how that lack and loss of home manifested.
Yeah, there's also something that he says right at the end of that first paragraph that he chewed them raw, yams and years ago, more yams than years ago, though the time seemed endlessly expanded, stretched thin as the spiraling smoke, beyond all recall. That bit, I could completely feel this total obsession with food because I have it myself, and so I knew exactly what that felt like.
Any other questions? I think we've got time for one more, maybe two.
Just there.
Hi, my name is Shadi Peets. I'm from Jackson, Mississippi, and I also have a nonprofit called Growing Resilience in the South. And we use food to tell stories and amplify the voices of our elders in history. And I could relate to that because I really connect with the food stories my grandmother shared with me. And so I think that's why I'm so passionate about sharing these food stories. So mm-hmm.
Absolutely. I think of poetry, and I've talked about this before, Oh, sorry, yes. Do I use poetry as a way to amplify my grandmother's, or I'm going to take that farther to say ancestors in general? And the answer is yes, absolutely. I think I said I have a particular historical bent, and so some readers of my work think it's quite old-fashioned, but I'm not interested in what is happening right now, today, in my own time. I'm interested in preserving things that were not preserved in my ancestors' time. That's not only the ancestors that I knew in this life, but the ones that I learned about. And all of the stories that exist in Pelham, I wrote down, as my grandmother told me, when I was 14. And after she died, Rena, you'll remember this from Mr. Kidder's class. He gave us a world history project where we had to interview the oldest person we knew and write something about them. So I wrote these things down when I was 14, and I didn't think about them anymore. When my grandmother passed away and I was settling her estate, she kept the copy of my paper, and that's how I had the memories. So I've incorporated them into the poems.
And there was a final question.
There was a final question here.
Yeah, I just wanted to drill down a little bit into your process. Mm-hmm. Like, are you setting aside time to write, or just waiting on inspiration?
I'm blessed that I don't need to set aside time for writing. I make time to write in my daily life. I also am lucky that if you ask me to write an essay, it would take me I don't know how long, or I would get writer's block. But when it comes to poetry, I have never had writer's block. I always have something to write about. I always have multiple projects that I'm working on. And it seems exhaustive. It seems, I don't know how people have writer's block, because there's so much to write about, if not from your own experience, then from your reading. I get inspired very often by what I read as well. And as I said, a little small snippet of language will take me off, and I'll be writing a poem about it, or it will find its way into something that I'm writing. But if you are a writer yourself, and finding it hard to find time to write, there are definitely opportunities out there for writers to have residencies and time off space from their work and their daily lives so that they can focus on their writing, and I take advantage of those. Often, as in fact, this scene that you see on the screen was from a small house that was owned by a poet named Amy Clampett. Those are her dishes, in fact. She died 30 years ago. But I was on a writing residency for 6 months, and so I had my family come there for Thanksgiving dinner. So yeah, they're all the time. There's all the time to write and all the opportunity.
Make time. Thank you all so very much for coming out on this rainy Saturday morning. Thank you,
absolutely.
Dante. This has been just exhilarating.
Yeah.
Brought the sun out. And I'm supposed to remind you, or to suggest to you, that if you haven't seen the Orchid Show, it is glorious. Go get some inspiration from the blooms. And I think the corpse flower may have bloomed. So it is pretty awesome. It's enormous and stinky. So go see the corpse flower too. Thank you all so very much for coming. Thank you, Dante.